1942, France is conquered. Russia's army is being pushed back, and U.S. troops landing in Africa soon will face Rommel. But the world is about to be drastically changed, and it will happen under these stadium stands at the University of Chicago. Hello, I'm Jim Wilhelm. As you may recall, that was the location of a highly classified experiment. It was there that the first controlled, self-sustaining nuclear reaction was achieved. The atomic age was born. The team that split the atom that day was led by Dr. Enrico Fermi, who jubilantly wrote in his notebook, "We're cooking." Later, a bottle is opened in celebration, and the team signs the basket. It's the only record made of those present. They would go on to build two more atomic piles in a forest preserve near Chicago. After the war, the federal government decided to keep the scientific teams together by creating a series of national laboratories. The first one was located here, about 23 miles south of Chicago. Interestingly, this first facility was named after the forest preserve that the team had just left, Argonne. And by the way, that forest was named after one of the costliest battles of World War I. Anyway, what began as a few Quonset huts in 1946 has now grown into a premier research facility employing over 4,000 people, attracting scientists from around the globe. Originally, its mission was to study peaceful uses for nuclear energy. In fact, almost every type of reactor in use today was conceived here, including the first nautical reactor that was placed on board the USS Nautilus. Today's teams are working on the problem of spent fuel, trying to reduce the volume of waste that will need long-term storage. While most of the nuclear research has moved to other areas of the country, energy remains at the forefront of Argonne's mission. For example, the development of new fuel cells, which could replace the combustion engine. Yet energy is only part of the focus. Today, the Visitor Center offers guests an overview of some of the 200 ongoing projects in several scientific fields. Projects that range from the development of non-polluting lubricants to microscopic motors. In addition, the lab also provides classrooms with programs and contests to give students a hands-on experience. And for researchers around the world, Argonne provides some of the biggest and best tools for exploring matter. The desire to probe atomic structures led to this apparatus. While it may appear that we're in the utility room of an office building, this is a very sophisticated piece of hardware. It's the Argonne Tandem Linear Accelerator System, and it's one big ion gun. This is the world's first superconducting accelerator for projectiles heavier than an electron. Inside that caged area, an ion beam is created from the material scientists want to study. The beam is shot through this pipe and is constantly sped up until it's traveling about 15% of the speed of light. And then, bang, it hits a target. By studying the gamma rays and the particles emitted from that crash, scientists can learn more about the nucleus of certain atoms. Now, earlier we said this system was superconducting. It uses just 1/10 of the electricity of other accelerators. This is what does the trick. This is a resonator. And inside, the double comma shape produces rapidly alternating positive and negative fields, 97 million times per second, pushing and pulling the ion beam along the path. There are 62 of these resonators in the system. They're made from the metal niobium, which is found worldwide. In fact, it was first discovered in 1801 in an ore sample over 100 years old, which had been sent to England by the first governor of Connecticut. Anyway, besides the material, the secret to being superconductive is to keep the metal extremely cold. This is a helium refrigerator. The resonators are filled with liquid helium at minus 452 degrees. That's just 4 degrees above absolute zero. In addition, the entire pipeline is vacuum sealed. Since it first went into operation, Argonne's accelerator has provided more than 55,000 beam hours to researchers from 94 institutions in the United States and 18 foreign countries. Plus, it can run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Even with all those operational hours, this system still cannot handle the demand. Twice as many hours have been requested on this system as are now available, and plans are already in the works for a new addition to study unstable ions. One of the functions of the Argonne National Lab is to provide researchers with access to the latest and very expensive tools, such as this one. It's a way for U.S. scientists to remain competitive and to strengthen our technological base. These pipes and conduits are part of the advanced photon source, which is housed in this circular building. Inside, high-powered X-ray beams are generated, allowing scientists to see arrangements of atoms that make molecules. This is the first and only such facility in the United States, and only one of three in the world functioning at this high power level. Completed at the cost of $820 million, it delivered its first X-ray beam in 1995, just 100 years after Rontgen discovered X-rays. Here's how it works. Just inside the ring, an electron beam is generated and then sent to a booster, which is like a warm-up track, where electrons are constantly sped up. Once they reach 7 billion electron volts, which is nearly the speed of light, the beam is injected into the outer storage ring. The beam traverses this two-thirds of a mile circuit 270,000 times a second. Special precautions had to be taken to isolate the building against any vibration because the beam has to be delivered to a target the size of a human hair. At various locations around the ring, the beam is siphoned off into lead-lined rooms where samples are hit with the intense X-ray. The amount of energy passed through or diffracted creates a pattern of dots which can be turned into a 3D model. This is where the photons are managed for one of the experiments. Well, what does all this mean to us? Well, now pharmaceutical companies can explore the structure of certain disease-causing molecules, which can lead to better vaccines. In fact, the 3D model that we just saw is the structure of the cholera toxin. By studying the position of atoms, new materials can be created. It's also possible to trace the movement and the position of atoms during chemical reactions. Jutting around the storage ring's exterior are the labs and offices belonging to research teams using the advanced photon source. While Argonne provides the beam, the lab equipment to study the results must be supplied by the users. It's a hefty investment that could reach millions of dollars. The beam is provided free of charge as long as the researchers agree to publish the results. In addition, each user must make 25% of their research time available for groups that can't afford the lab equipment. Also, the state of Illinois has invested millions of dollars in APS research to support scientists in Illinois. When this facility first moved here in 1946, some of the local residents refused to leave, and they have become quite an attraction. On spring and fall mornings, guests are liable to catch a glimpse of some of the white deer that call these grounds home. This is not an albino herd, but a naturally light-colored species native to North Africa and Europe. Originally, they wandered the country estate of Gustav Freund, who later sold his land to Argonne. By the way, Gustav made his fortune as the inventor of the skinless hot dog casing. Anyway, he eventually got rid of the deer because they were chewing up his orchard, but apparently a couple survived and has since repopulated the herd. Today the herd is not owned by anyone, but is free to come and go. When it first opened, Argonne consisted of 3,500 acres. Since then, some of the land has been sold to the local Forest Preserve District, which has 8.5 miles of bike and hiking trails, which also can be used for cross-country skiing in the wintertime. What began as a reaction that changed the world continues to affect our lives today. Yet what we've seen today is just a small fraction of Argonne's ongoing projects, projects that have attracted worldwide attention. For those interested in learning more, the Visitor Center is open to the public Tuesday through Thursday. Tours of the facility are available by appointment only. Also, keep in mind that certain areas of the lab have age restrictions. Every 2 years, Argonne does throw its doors open to the public, setting up tents around the grounds, offering demonstrations and lectures by special guests. For more information on tours, call 630-252-5562 or visit their website at www.anl.gov.